Good morning. This is the Macro Church of Christ. Excuse me. Sorry about that. I needed to check, make sure the recording levels were good. Good morning. This is the Macro Church of Christ, a Sunday Samuel to Chronicle study. We're in 1 Samuel 17:31, that famous story about David and Goliath. We'll be talking about him in just a minute and continue with that story. But again, I'm going to just simply show you this chart that's made by Moody Press, and I got it way back in the 80s. And it's the Book of Samuel, of course. And notice that we're dealing with Samuel, who was the first prophet and priest. And we have the transition between that. He was also the transition between judges and a king. And Saul became the first king. And remember that we're in his rule now. And David has just been appointed or has been anointed as the future king that's going to come from God because God rejected Saul. And so in all realities, David was the king. Now, as we looked at that, we noticed that there seemed to be, at least the way it looked, a problem in chronology. And so remember that as we go through here and as we take a look at these various stories. And remember that it's possible that it's just a little bit out of chronology. And if it is, it really doesn't matter. It doesn't change anything as far as the story is concerned or the reliability of the scriptures. It's just simply a method that the Hebrew writers often use in order to emphasize what was important as they were telling a story. And so that's the reason that you have those things that are recorded for us. And so if you do believe it's out of chronological order, it's all right. And so you don't have to panic. But there are people who try to attempt to harmonize a chronology, but I think it's rather strained. So I believe that the chronology is a little out of order here. And so we've been noticing that. Now notice that as we looked at the first 30 verses of 1 Samuel 17, that we have the story of David and Goliath, and you're looking at the eSword vision here, or picture, if you're watching this online. And we notice that David had been told by his father to take some provisions to his brothers, his three older brothers that were in the army as the army was facing the Philistines. Remember that they were on in a place where there was like two hills and a valley in between, and the armies were on the hills. And so every day the armies would line up, you know, kind of like who's going to make the first move to actually charge the other people. And in the middle, they had Goliath, and Goliath would come in the middle and he would taunt the children of Israel, and he would say that if you defeat him, then the Philistines will be the slaves of the Hebrews. But if the Hebrews beats the Goliath, then the Philistines will be their slaves. And so we noticed that as David came, that he noticed that Goliath made that challenge, and nobody was taking it up. And then he also learned that whoever would do that would receive some privileges from Saul. He would be considered, he would have be given Saul's oldest daughter as a wife, and therefore he would become a member of royalty. His personal family would be free and therefore would not have to pay taxes. And so there were a number of benefits that he saw or that he would receive if he or anybody was able to defeat Goliath. And so when he heard that, he kind of asked to make sure that that was true. And his brother got mad at him, Eliab, because he thought he was just sticking his nose into a place where it shouldn't be. And so this is one of the reasons that I believe that the chronology is not necessarily chronological order, or that the way it's recorded isn't. Because David had already been anointed king by Samuel, and it was in the midst of his brothers, it says, that he was anointed. It's certainly possible that they might have not known why he was anointed, but it seems rather strange that David wouldn't know why he was appointed. And so he would certainly use that anointing as a means whereby he would have the right to do this. But he doesn't, so therefore I don't believe that happened before the Battle of David and Goliath. I believe it happened after, which is also one of the reasons why God picked David, because David demonstrated that he was a man of faith, unlike Saul. And so when David had mentioned that to the people, in other words, he wanted to know what Saul had really meant about what rewards somebody would get if they defeat Goliath, then the people were going to discuss that with Saul. Now, verse 31, it says, when the word which David spoke were heard, they told them to Saul, and he sent for him. And David said to Saul, let no man's heart fail on account of him. That's the Philistine. Your servant will go and fight with this Philistine. Then Saul said to David, you are not able to go against this Philistine to fight with him, for you are but a youth, while he has been a warrior from his youth. But David said to Saul, your servant was tending his father's sheep when a lion or a bear came and took a lamb from the flock. I went out after him and attacked him and rescued it from his mouth. And when he rose up against me, I seized him by his beard and struck him and killed him. Your servant has killed both the lion and the bear, and this uncircumcised Philistine will be like one of them, since he has taunted the armies of the living God. And David said, the Lord, who delivered me from the paw of the lion and from the paw of the bear, he will deliver me from the hand of this Philistine. And Saul said to David, go, and may the Lord be with you. So now what I want you to notice here is that as we begin to look further into the story, as Saul hears about David asking about the rewards of the person who defeats Goliath, that Saul then decided he wanted to talk to him. And so it says, when the words which David spoke were heard, those are the words about, you know, what will the person receive if they defeat Goliath from Saul? Those are the words. Now, when Saul heard those, he says they told him to Saul, and he sent for him. So Saul calls David. He's going to talk to David. And it said, and David says to Saul, let no man's heart fail on account of him. Your servant will go and fight with this Philistine. So basically, David says that he'll take care of the problem, and the men don't need to be faint of heart or be worried about it. And that's one of the reasons why they hadn't gone out and fought against him or put out a challenger or a champion in order to defeat Goliath, because they were failing in heart. Their understanding of what they were able to do and what God would do for them had failed because of this Philistine. Because remember how impressive he looked and how warrior-like he appeared and how huge he was. And the Philistines were basically a ragtag army where they just had a few implements of war. And so in verse 33, it says, then Saul said to David, you are not able to go against this Philistine to fight with him, for you are but a youth, while he has been a warrior from his youth. So basically what Saul says is you're unqualified physically in order to go out and fight against him, because number one, you're just a kid to begin with. And number two, he's been practicing and been a warrior all of his life. And that might be true from a physical standpoint, but God's people have never relied on the physical. God's people have always relied on what God says. And if God says that they can defeat their enemies, then they can defeat their enemies. If God says they're going to fall to their enemies, then they're going to fall to their enemies. And of course, that reminds me of when the children of Israel were supposed to enter into the land of Canaan back in the book of Numbers and Deuteronomy and Exodus. When they were supposed to enter the land of Canaan, and the 12 spies came back, and 10 of them said, we can't do it. And the people believed the 10 spies and therefore weren't able to go in. But when they saw that God had prophesied that they would all die in the wilderness for the next 40 years, those men of war, then they changed their mind and they said, let's go fight against the Philistines. And of course they lost. And that's because God wasn't with them. So it has nothing to do with our physical ability. It has everything to do with what God says. And that's why the scriptures teach that if you're blessed by God, then you can chase 1,000 men, he says. And it says, and then Saul said to David, you're not able to go against the Philistine to fight with him, for you are but a youth. And not only that, but sometimes we have the idea that because we're young, we don't have the ability or the wisdom to do what it is that God wants us to do. And so the world holds us back because we're young. And that's why Paul told Timothy, let no man despise your youth. because it has nothing to do, when we're preaching the word of God, it has nothing to do with how old the messenger is. It has to do with how old the word of God is. If somebody's really preaching the word of God, whether you're a young man or whether you're a young woman, no matter who you might be, if you're using the word of God, you're teaching people to follow God, then you shouldn't have to worry about your youth or physical circumstances, because what we're teaching and what we're preaching is not ourselves, but we're preaching whatever the word of God says. Not only that, but he says that the Philistine Goliath had been a warrior from his youth, so he had trained in the art of war. Now the problem is that he trained in the art of physical war, and he used his physical abilities, his armor, his might, his power, his strength, his height. He used all those things to his advantage, and none of the most impressive physical things that somebody has is going to stand against the spiritual influences of God. And so David points out that he is capable, although he's going to point out that it wasn't him in just a minute. He says, but David says in verse 34 to Saul, "Your servant was tending his father's sheep when a lion or a bear came and took the lamb from the flock. I went out after him and attacked him and rescued it from his mouth. And when he rose up against me, I seized him by his hand and struck him and killed him." Now, one of the things that this shows you is that David understood what it was to fight against what seemed to be enormous opponents. Here, he speaks about the fact that he went out and killed a lion and a bear, because his duty was to guard the sheep, his father's sheep. And therefore, whenever a lion or a bear or a wolf or whatever animal might come out to try to devour the sheep came out, the shepherd was supposed to protect them. And so when it says that one of the lambs was taken by one of these individuals, that he rescued it from his mouth. And it says, and when the animal, whether it was a lion or whether it was a bear, was against me, I seized him by his beard, and that's probably the lion that's under consideration, and struck him and killed him. And so David points out that he's killed a lion and he's killed a bear with his bare hands, and without being a warrior. And that's his point here, that he killed them without being a warrior and without being any bigger than he already is, as far as his physical stature goes. Now, verse 36 says, "And your servant has killed both the lion and the bear, and this uncircumcised Philistine will be like one of them, since he has taunted the armies of God." Now, he then points out that he has killed both the lion and the bear, and this uncircumcised Philistine will be like one of them. Now, when it says your servant has killed both the lion and the bear, you're going to notice in just a minute that he gives credit to the Lord. So when he says your servant has killed both the lion and the bear, in other words, what he's saying is that you have a man standing in front of you who trusts God to do the heavy lifting. He's trusting God who helped him kill the lion and the bear. Now, David had to do something, okay? As servants of God, we have to do something, but the strength belongs to the Lord. He's the one who gives us the ability to do whatever it is that we're supposed to do for him and for his people or for other people. And so he's the one that gives us the strength, but we have to decide to do it. See, the problem with the army is they didn't decide to go out and test God. Or if you want to put it like that, they didn't want to go out and see if God's word really meant what God's word meant. And that is that they have a covenant with God and God's going to deliver this army into their hands. And so he then points out this uncircumcised Philistine. And again, I'd like to emphasize that the idea of an uncircumcised person is an individual who doesn't have a covenant with God. So David is saying this person who God is not with is going to fall like the bear and the lion, because God has a covenant with us. And not only that, but he says, since he has taunted the armies of the living God. You see, David understood that these armies were God's armies. They belonged to God. If you remember, much of the time the army was referred to before, it was Saul's army, or those men who were under Saul. But David sees them as belonging to God. And that's the difference between the kingship of David and the kingship of Saul. Saul saw the army as if they belonged to him. David sees the army as if they belong to God. And that's the view of a shepherd. A shepherd looks at the sheep and they belong to another person. He's taking care of them. And so therefore he's going to act accordingly. But he points out that these are the armies of the living God, and they're making fun of them. They're taunting them. And so God, you might say, is looking bad. That's the way God looks. And so David's going to stop this. Now, verse 37. And David said, "The Lord who delivered me from the paw of the lion and from the paw of the bear, he will deliver me from the hand of this Philistine." So notice that David's argument is, I'm not the guy doing the fighting. So I know you're looking at me, and I'm young, and I'm not of the stature of a warrior. You know, I don't have a build. He looks more like a man of the house than he does a warrior. And so therefore, that's what they're looking at physically. But David is pointing out that he's not trusting in his physical abilities. He's trusting in God. Now, he is going to have to do something physically, but he's not relying on his physical might and power in order to defeat the Philistine. But he's depending on God, who said, whose army is being taunted and who is being ridiculed. And God is going to uphold and defend his honor. And so he says, "He will deliver me from the hand of this Philistine." And Saul said to David, "Go, and may the Lord be with you." And so Saul decided to give David a chance. Now, you might be thinking, is this a smart move for Saul, since the challenge was that if you defeat the Philistines, I mean, if you defeat Goliath, then the Philistines become your slaves. But if they defeat your champion, then you become their slaves. And so it might not look like a very good strategy to let this kid, from a physical standpoint, go out and fight against this Goliath individual. And so it might not look like the smartest thing to do, but here's what you need to remember. If the Philistines do defeat the champion, it doesn't mean that just because the challenge was made that they have to abide by it, you might say. They can still go out and fight. And not only that, but they're slaves of the Philistines right now anyway. So what would change as far as that's concerned? And so therefore, you might understand why it is that Saul allows David to do that. And not only that, but I'm sure that the Holy Spirit and God had an influence in the choice that Saul made, as God has in all of our choices. Now, verse 38, it says, beginning of verse 38, now that Saul has decided that David can go out and fight against the Philistine, they're going to equip him with what he needs. Verse 38 says, "Then Saul clothed David with his garments and put a bronze helmet on his head, and he clothed him with armor. And David girded his sword over his armor and tried to walk, for he had not tested them. So David said to Saul, 'I cannot go with these, for I have not tested them.' And David took them off. He took his stick in his hand and chose for himself five smooth stones from the brook, and put them in the shepherd's bag, which he had even in his pouch, and his sling was in his hand. And he approached the Philistine. Then the Philistine came on and approached David with the shield bearer in front of him. When the Philistine looked and saw David, he disdained him, for he was but a youth and ruddy with a handsome appearance. The Philistine said to David, 'Am I a dog that you come to me with sticks?' And the Philistine cursed David by his gods. The Philistine also said to David, 'Come to me, and I will give your flesh to the birds of the sky and the beasts of the field.' And then David said to the Philistine, 'You come to me with a sword, a spear, and a javelin, but I come to you in the name of the Lord of hosts, the God of the army of Israel, whom you have taunted. This day the Lord will deliver you up into my hand, and I will strike you down and remove your head from you. And I will give the dead bodies of the armies of the Philistines this day to the birds of the sky and to the wild beasts of the earth, that all the earth may know that there is a God in Israel, and that all this assembly may know that the Lord does not deliver by sword or by spear, for the battle is the Lord's, and he will give you into our hand.'" And I want to stop there at verse 47. So Saul decides that David can go. And so, like any warrior, you have to prepare him. You have to give him the things that he's going to need in order to go out and do battle. And of course, every army equips their men in order to do that with what they need: a rifle, a helmet, boots and, you know, certain clothes and all those things. And generally speaking, the better that a person is armored or equipped, the more likely he is to win. And so Saul clothed David with his garments. Now, remember that there wasn't a lot of military equipment during those days because they were under the conquest of the Philistines, and the Philistines wouldn't allow them to have blacksmiths and wouldn't allow them to have swords and spears, swords. As far as we know, only David and Jonathan had swords, and maybe some of the swords that they had captured from other Philistine battles, but probably not too many. And so there wasn't a whole lot of different options or sizes in order to give to David. So Saul, remember, was head and shoulders above everybody else, gave him his bronze helmet on his head, and he clothed him with armor. And so it's kind of like if you have a motorcycle and you have an adult helmet, and you put it on your son or your daughter that's young in order to ride with you, and the helmet is wobbly and loose and doesn't fit them real well. That's because it's not suited for them. And that's what you find out here with the armor. He was clothed with the armor. And so verse 39 says, "And David girded his sword over his armor and tried to walk, for he had not tested them." The idea of tested them means that he hadn't become accustomed to using them. And not only that, but they were big. And it says, "So David said to Saul, 'I cannot go with these, for I have not tested them.' And David took them off." So David says, this stuff is worthless. You know, I don't know how to use it, and I can't move in it. And so it's not good. Sometimes we rely on physical things more than we ought to. And since we haven't tested those physical things to see if they'll really hold up to the situation, we sometimes depend on those physical things instead of depending on God, but not David. David took them off, and it says in verse 40, "And he took his stick in his hand," and that would be his shepherd's staff, "in his hand, and chose for himself 5 smooth stones from the brook, and put them in the shepherd's bag, which he had, even in his pouch, and his sling was in his hand, and he approached the Philistine." So David took out these stones that he had. David took what he was used to, and what he used. He took his staff, and he took a bag of rocks, and he picked out 5 smooth stones. Somebody once said that maybe he picked out 5 smooth stones because Goliath had four brothers, and he was going to have to fight against them. That's possible, but it's interesting that 5 in the Bible usually represents the idea of some. He took some stones, and for example, when Matthew chapter 25 talks about the 10 virgins, it says 5 were foolish and 5 were wise. But 5 seems to be the number that represents some of whatever it is that you're dealing with. Jesus fed 5,000 with some loaves and some fishes. And so he fed some of the people of that day. He didn't feed everybody in the world. And so more than likely 5 just simply represents he took what he needed, or he took some smooth stones from the brook. Now, notice that David was not equipped with the armor or with the sword, but he understood slingshots. He understood how they worked. So God was going to use David's ability to be able to accomplish what God wanted to accomplish. David didn't all of a sudden have to know how to use all these implements in order to succeed. God was able to use whatever David knew about in order to accomplish his deed. And that's what we need to remember too. We don't have to have a college education in order for God to provide for us. We don't have to be beautiful in order for us to be able to influence other people. We don't have to put on makeup and do all those kinds of things that women do. And don't misunderstand me. I'm not opposed to ladies looking nice or even putting on a little bit of makeup, but it shouldn't be to the extent that that's what they're concerned about, or men who spend all their time exercising so that their bodies look impressive, but they're not really faithful to the Lord. There's nothing wrong with exercise, and certainly it helps in a physical way and can help you do your tasks. But nonetheless, our reliance needs to be on God. And so it says, he took his stick in his hand and chose for himself five smooth stones, because that's, he understood those things. And he understood how his stick worked, his staff, because he used it all the time. And so God used what he was able to incorporate and put them into the shepherd's bag, which he had. And I think it's interesting that it's called a shepherd's bag, because a shepherd's bag is a bag that's used, of course, by a shepherd, but it's the implements that he needs in order to get the sheep to trust him. And so whatever he needs in order to do his job as a shepherd, he'd put in the bag, and his job is to lead the flock. And so he puts it in his shepherd's bag, which he had, even in his pouch. It says he had this little pouch. And so here comes David. He has a little pouch, you know, could be a fanny pack or a pouch over his shoulders. And he has this pouch, and he has a staff, and he has a slingshot. You know, I don't know if you could really see it. And he approached the Philistine. Now, here you have a kid who doesn't have any armament. He doesn't have a helmet. He doesn't have greaves on his shins. He doesn't have mail on. He's got no sword, no spear. And he's coming out probably in a robe. And he's coming to stand before before Goliath. And it says in verse 41, then the Philistine came on and approached David with his shield bearer in front of him. So here comes the Philistine, decked out in his armor and his apparel, and his shield bearer was in front of him. So he also had some support with him, where David came out alone. Verse 42 says, when the Philistine looked and saw David, he disdained him. In other words, he looked at David and goes, what in the world is this guy doing out here trying to challenge me? And it says, for he was but a youth and ruddy with a handsome appearance. So David was a young man, even to the point where Goliath understood that he was a young man and he was ruddy. In other words, he kind of had red hair. And so you take that to mean that he was, he had also maybe a pale complexion, and he was a handsome guy, but he wasn't a warrior. You know, he's not what you would consider as a warrior or as a military man. He would be somebody that would, you might consider as a butler maybe, but certainly not as a warrior. And so he disdained him. And what we need to remember is that when we're serving God, the world might see us as somebody to disdain, somebody to look down upon. But when we're doing what God says, it doesn't matter how people view us. What matters is how we view ourselves. And that's why the children of Israel weren't able to enter the promised land. Because if you remember, when the spies came out and told them how strong and powerful and fortified the cities were, the people said, or the spies said, we were like grasshoppers and they were like giants. And so they saw themselves as grasshoppers and the Philistines the Canaanites as giants. And so that's what you also have here. So the question isn't how it looks physically. The question is, what are you thinking in your heart? And so we know what's in the Philistine's heart. This kid, he's a kid and he's coming out to me. And so look at what the Philistine says in verse 43. And the Philistine said to David, am I a dog that you come to me with sticks? And the Philistine cursed David by his gods. So basically the Philistine said, this guy's a kid. Do you guys think that I'm so puny, that I'm so miserable, that I'm so weak, that you think this kid is going to be able to come out and defeat me? You think I'm a dog that you can take a stick, you can, you know, wag a stick at me and I'm going to run away? And so he cursed David by his gods. In other words, he swore to David and made an oath concerning David by the Philistine's god, who would be Dagon. And you remember that was the Dagon who fell before the Ark of the Covenant when it had been captured. And I don't know if they ever fixed the hands and the head of Dagon, but that's the god that he's cursing David by. And of course, when the Ark of the Covenant was captured and taken into Dagon's temple, the Ark of the Covenant proved that the Ark of the Covenant represented the real God, and Dagon is just this fake God. Now, verse 44, and the Philistine also said to David, come to me, and I will give your flesh to the birds of the sky and to the beasts of the field. Now this expression, give your flesh to the birds of the sky and the beasts of the field, is the idea that you're going to be laying dead and the vultures are going to come and eat you. It's this same picture that's used in Revelation to speak about the fact that God was going to destroy the Roman Empire and defeat them. And they were going to be like bodies that were left for the birds to come and eat because they're going to be defeated and destroyed. And certainly today there are no Romans. There are no people from the nation of Rome. There's people from the city of Rome, but they're Italian. The nation of Rome has been defeated. One of the world's greatest world empires at the time was defeated by the Christian movement, when I say Christian movement, I'm talking about God's movement in the lives of Christians, and it was defeated. And in so that's what he's pointing out. Now, verse 45 says, then David said to the Philistine, you come to me with swords, a spear, and a javelin, but I come to you in the name of the Lord, the God of the armies of Israel, whom you have taunted. So David says, yeah, you look impressive. You look big. You come to me with armament. You come to me with sword and a big shield in front of you and mail all over the place so that I can't hurt you. But you come to me trusting in your physical power and might. David says, I come to you in the name of the Lord. When he speaks about the name of the Lord, yeah, that's an expression that we find in the New Testament when it talks about the name of Jesus was exalted and people were believing in his name. The idea of the name of the Lord doesn't simply mean that David is coming and going and saying, Jehovah, Jehovah, as he comes. What it means is that he's coming in the character of the Lord. And what is the character of the Lord? You don't make fun of him. He's the holy God. He's the God of gods. He's gonna prove that he's the God of gods. Now, he's also kind and gracious, but when people upset him or when people don't recognize him, then he's going to prove to them who the real God is, just like he did with Dagon when the Ark of the Covenant had been brought into their temple. And so David says, I'm coming to you in the name of the Lord, and the name of the Lord is his character, and he's the ruler of the whole world. He's the warrior that fought for Israel to bring them out of the land of Egypt. He's that God. And so he says, David says, I'm coming to you in the name of the Lord of hosts and the God of the armies of Israel. And so he says, points out again that these aren't Saul's armies. These are God's armies that you've been making fun of. You've been taunting these armies. And so he's going to come out and fight against you. Now, verse 46 says, and this day the Lord will deliver you up into my hand, and I will strike you down and remove your head from you, and I will give the dead bodies of the armies of the Philistines this day to the birds of the sky and the wild beasts of the earth, that all the earth may know that there is a God in Israel. And so one of the things that David points out is that because he's coming in the name of the Lord will deliver you. See, David, even though David, when he was talking with Saul, said, I have killed the bear and the lion, even in that story, he pointed out that he understood that David delivered them by the power of God. And so here, David is coming, not in his own physical might, but in the power of the Lord. And the Lord is the one who's going to deliver them. The Lord is the one who's going to save them into my hands. He says, and I will strike you down and remove your head from you. Now, he says that to Goliath, but he doesn't even have a sword. How's he gonna take his head off him? Is he gonna chew his neck off? Like the zombie movies that you watch on television, or The Living Dead, or The Walking Dead. How's he gonna do that? Well, once he defeats Saul, once he defeats Goliath, he can take his time and do whatever he needs to do. But he's gonna remove his head. And the idea of removing your head, of course, is defeating you. And it says, and I will give the dead bodies of the armies of the Philistines this day to the birds of the sky and to the wild beasts of the earth. Notice that David says, and I will give the dead bodies. Now, when he says, I will give them, he's not taking credit from God. What he's pointing out is God is using him as the servant who's going to accomplish this. And God is working through David. See, we have to work with God. God allows us to work with him. And that proves our faith in him when we work with him. If we just sit back and do nothing and say, okay, I'm going to trust God and I'm not going to do anything except just sit around here, then we don't understand the activity of God. God has always required his people to work with him. But in their working with him, they work with him because they trust God. And so therefore, though nobody else could touch the Ark of the Covenant, the Levites could touch the Ark of the Covenant because they were working with God and God was working with them and they were trusting God. And that's exactly what we have going on here. And that's what we have in every situation. If you're a mom, then God is working with you to raise your child in the nurture and admonition of the Lord. But if all you care about is their physical well-being, if all you care about is how pretty your daughters look and how braided their hair is and how their complexions are, but you really don't care about whether they're virgins or you don't care about whether they're going to stay faithful to God, or that you don't care about bringing them to church, then what good is it? Same thing with men. If men are more concerned about making their sons into men of war and businessmen and people that the world will respect, but they don't bring them to know Jesus or to know God, then what good is it? It's not going to do them any good. And so we need to remember that it's God that matters. And so we're supposed to work with God. And in working with God, then we're doing his will. And that's why the New Testament says that the church is God's body, because that's how God works today. We work with our bodies. We do things with our bodies. Well, God works with his body, but his body always has to have faith, has to trust him. The Israelite army didn't, or they would have challenged this guy the first time he set foot in the valley. And so David says, and I will give the dead bodies of the armies of the Philistines this day to the birds of the sky and to the wild beasts of the earth. So David said, God's working through me and he's going to do this, but I am his instrument at this time. And it says that all the earth, now why is he going to do this? Why would God do such a thing? He says that all the earth may know that there is a God in Israel. Now, didn't they know there was a God in Israel before? Apparently not. Because the Philistines made that challenge 40 days ago, and nobody in Israel stepped up and said, look, our God is able to defeat you. Nobody said that. So it looked like there was no God in Israel. And so David says, I'm coming out to you, and I'm coming out to you looking weak. I'm coming out to you looking powerless, and I'm going to show you that God, there is a God in Israel. And that's why the Apostle Paul says that he glories in his weaknesses. Well, why is that? Because it's in our weaknesses that we develop. It's in our weaknesses that we have to trust God. Now, we still have to do whatever God wants us to do. But when we're weak and we do what God says, then we're putting our trust that God is going to accomplish the task and not us. And that's what we need to remember. God's the one who accomplishes the task and not us. But we have to work with God to carry out his will, because he's looking for people to carry out his will. And when we do that, then people know that there is a God in Israel when we believe and trust what God says. Now, verse 47, and that all the assembly may know that the Lord does not deliver by sword or by spear, for the battle is the Lord's and he will give you into our hands. And so notice what he said. It wasn't just the Philistine army that needed to know that there was a God, but the assembly of God, the army of God needed to know that God was behind them. Now, that's what a leader does. A leader helps people understand that God is behind them and that they're going to trust God. Saul was more concerned about the physical things. He was more concerned about his own reputation. He's more concerned about his own honor. He was more concerned about how he looked than he was about how God looked. And so, therefore, Saul wasn't the best leader. And didn't lead the men in such a way that they put their trust in God. They were putting their trust in the military might of their king, who was head and shoulders above everybody else. But when a Philistine came out that was 9 feet tall, all of a sudden now they can't rely on Saul, because Saul was relying on his strength and his appearance, just like Goliath was. And so they didn't think there was a God in Israel. They weren't looking to God in Israel. But if David defeats this Philistine, then they're going to know that there is a God in Israel, because they're going to know that the only way David was able to defeat Goliath was by the intervention of God, as David believed in what God told him he could do. And so don't forget that, brothers and sisters. And don't forget that, fathers and mothers, that God will help us do whatever we need to do, no matter how difficult it might be. God will help us do it as long as we're doing it according to his way and in order to bring him glory and honor by helping us in these matters. And by the way, God was brought glory here because evil was defeated and good was vindicated. And that's what we need to remember. God looks good when evil is defeated and justice is vindicated. And that's why our country isn't looking too good nowadays, because it seems that we're more concerned about what people want rather than justice. And so we have protests that turn into violence, and there's nothing that the police can do, and there's nothing that our politicians want them to do about it, because basically our politicians are using that in order to promote their own agendas, rather than promoting law and order and loving kindness in our nation. Now, verse 47 says, "And that all this assembly may know that the Lord does not deliver by sword or by spear." So God doesn't deliver us by our physical might or physical power or our ability. And as a nation, we need to remember that if ever we go to war. If a nation goes to war, they need to remember that God's the one who delivers them. Now, of course, the wars we have today are a little different than the wars they had back then, because those were implemented by God. But nonetheless, the point is the same. It says, "For the battle is the Lord's, and he will give you into our hands." So again, notice, it's the Lord who's doing it. The Lord is going to give the Philistine into his hand. And so David's faith is trusting in God, whereas Saul's faith was trusting in himself and his might and his army and the people that were with him. And so God needs a shepherd who leads people to trust in God and not to trust in themselves or in a physical church building or in some physical arguments, but to trust that God can do what God said he's going to accomplish. Now, verse 48 says, "Then it happened when the Philistines rose and came and drew near to meet David, that David ran quickly toward the battle line to meet the Philistine. And David put his hands into his bag and took from it a stone and slung it and struck the Philistine on his forehead. And the stone sank into his forehead so that he fell on his face to the ground. Thus, David prevailed over the Philistine with a sling and a stone, and he struck the Philistine and killed him. But there was no sword in David's hand. Then David ran and stood over the Philistine and took his sword and drew it out of his sheath and killed him and cut off his head with it. When the Philistines saw that their champion was dead, they fled. The men of Israel and Judah arose and shouted and pursued the Philistines as far as the valley and to the gate of Ekron. And the slain Philistines lay along the way to Shearim, even to Gath and Ekron. And the sons of Israel returned from chasing the Philistines and plundered their camps. Then David took the Philistine's head and brought it to Jerusalem, but he put his weapon in his tent. Now when Saul saw David going out against the Philistines, he said to Abner, the commander of his army, "Abner, whose son is this young man?" And Abner said, By your life, O king, I do not know." The king said, "You inquire whose son the youth is." So when David returned from killing the Philistine, Abner took him and brought him before Saul and the Philistine's head in his with the Philistine's head in his hand. And Saul said to him, "Whose son are you, young man?" And David answered, "I am the son of your servant, Jesse, the Bethlehemite." All right, so here we have the actual battle. And so there's the impressive Goliath standing before David, who is this shepherd boy that's come in a robe and a shepherd's staff and a shepherd's bag and a slingshot. And remember that their slingshots aren't like our slingshots, where you have, you know, a piece of rubber attached to a branch that looks like a Y, and you have this sack, you know, little sack in the middle that holds your little rock that you're sewing. Their sling was basically two leather thongs, and they were attached to each other with a little pocket, and you would swing that over your head. You would swing it, and, you know, in a circle motion, you'd swing it, and then you'd release one of the ends, and the rock would come out. And so people can, individuals who use those quite often could get pretty accurate with them. And so again, remember that God is using whatever talents David has to accomplish the work that God needs done. Now, verse 48, then it happened when the Philistines rose and came and drew near to David to meet David, that David ran quickly towards the battle line to meet the Philistines. Now notice that David wasn't intimidated. David wasn't fearful. The other men trembled whenever they saw Goliath and he came out and challenged them. But as David knew that he now had permission to go fight against the Philistine, he went with confidence to the battle, knowing that God was on his side. God always causes us to be confident and to trust in him and to trust in his way. So he ran out to the Philistine. He didn't wait for the Philistine to come to him. He ran to him with that Philistine. Verse 49 says, and David put his hand into his bag and took from it a stone and slung it. And so as he's running, David pulls out this rock, puts it in the sling, and twirls it around his head, and he throws it at the Philistine, and it finds his forehead. And the stone sank into his forehead so that he fell on his face to the ground. Now, I know this literally happened, and I don't want to imply in any way that it didn't literally happen. I believe it literally happened. What I find interesting is that they have had found, helmets of individuals who would fight fight at that time. And many of them covered like their head, of course it covered their head, but it covered also the front of their face and left a spot for their eyes and left their forehead open. And that's where the stone hit it. Now, isn't it interesting that the stone hits him on the head? And you might say, well, where else would the stone? Well, it could have hit him anywhere else, but it hits him on the head, and it was a stone. Well, why is that interesting? Well, because until the rock, Jesus, sinks into your head, you are his enemy. But once Jesus, who is called the rock, and of course, he's not just a little pebble, he's a huge rock, but here nonetheless, you have this image of this rock penetrating this guy's head, and he physically dies, that it's not until Jesus gets into our head that he either kills us or defeats us and we become his. And if you remember, that's what was going to happen if David defeated the Philistines. They were going to become slaves of Israel. And so in essence, they were going to become slaves of God. And this happened because that stone sunk into the forehead of Goliath. In other words, they finally understood that there was a God who they needed to submit to. And that's the God of Israel. And so there's some types that are going on in here. And certainly you see David as the king and defeating Goliath, this giant of an individual. And it says that he struck the Philistine and killed him. So he killed him with that one stone. But David didn't have a sword, and he said he was going to chop off his head, verse 51. And then David ran and took stood over the Philistine and took his sword and drew it out of its sheath and killed him. And so he took out the Goliath's sword and killed him with his own weapon. And that's what happens a lot of times when you're in the world and you're doing the things of the world. Those things that you trusted in end up killing you. For example, individuals who trust in their might and their ability and their power, there's always somebody who's bigger and stronger than them that ends up killing them or defeating them. Individuals who get hooked on drugs, drugs end up killing them. Individuals who get hooked on pornography, the pornography ends up killing them, and some of them physically and ruining their life because they're trusting in those things instead of trusting in God, who is the one who blesses them. And it says, oh, by the way, you notice that apparently the armor bearer ran off? Yeah, he did. Because what happens is when you come to the world with Jesus and with God, then all of the weapons and the implements of the world are going to fall before you. And so it says, when the Philistines saw that the champion was dead, they fled. Now, here's what I want to know. What changed in the army of God that all of a sudden the Philistines are now afraid and they're running away? What was it that changed? Their attitude. And God with the children of Israel. It's their attitude that changed. When the Philistines saw that the champion was dead, they fled. And of course, God tells us that he's the one that makes our enemies flee before us. And so it says that one Israelite can chase 1,000 of his enemy because God turns their hearts away after they understand who God is. So now that they understood that David's God could defeat their champion with just a shepherd boy and a rock, they then fled. They knew they were in trouble. And not only that, but the men of Israel, they also gained some strength and some attitude adjustment. Verse 52 says, the men of Israel and Judah arose and shouted and pursued the Philistines as far as the valley. So before they were fearful and were afraid. Now all of a sudden they've had an attitude adjustment by what it was that David did. And now they're pursuing the Philistines and they're shouting and they're going after them. You see, that's what a leader does. That's what a shepherd does. A shepherd doesn't tell people what to do. A shepherd goes in front of people and leads them, just like a shepherd leads his flock, and his flock trusts him, and his flock is willing to follow him because he's protects them. He's killed the lion and the bear. He has helped them in their endeavors to stay safe, and he has fed them and led them to waters, and that's one of the reasons why this picture is used in Revelation chapter 7 to speak about those individuals who have gone through the tribulation period, and they're with God in heaven, and they're called the unnumbered group. And it says that God, the Lamb was their shepherd, and he led them to living water and to pasture. That's what a shepherd does. And that's the way Jesus works. Jesus is not going to force anybody to serve him, because that's not what shepherds do. Now, he has the power and the ability and the right to do it, but he's not, because that's not the way his kingdom works. His kingdom works out of love, out of people choosing, because it's the right thing to do to serve him and glorify him. And so these Philistines, Israel then pursued the Philistines, and it says that they pursued them all the way to the gates of Ekron. That's their capital city. And it says, and the slain Philistines lay along the way to Shearim, even to Gath and to Ekron. So the very city that was protected by the Philistine God had all these bodies of the Philistines strewn, you know, thrown out everywhere as Israel was chasing them and killing them. Now that they had an adjustment attitude because they saw what their leader did. And so it says in verse 53, and the sons of Israel returned from chasing the Philistines and plundered their camp. It's always been like that. Those people who are enemies of God, God ends up using whatever resources they had for the benefit of God's people. And that's what you have here. That's what you have going on here. And so Israel defeated the Philistines and took possession of everything that they had. Just like when Israel entered in the land of Canaan and destroyed or defeated the majority of those seven nations that they were supposed to defeat and receive their property and their land and their cities and everything that they had, and they plundered them. And that's what you have going on here as the Philistines return. Now, verse 54 says, then David took the Philistine's head and brought it to Jerusalem. Now, when it says he brought it to Jerusalem, you and I are thinking, okay, he's bringing it to the capital of Israel. But Jerusalem at this time wasn't Jerusalem. Jerusalem at this time was a city that still hadn't been delivered from the Canaanite people that lived in it originally. David was the one who was actually going to go and do that. So maybe David took this Philistine's head and brought it to Jerusalem is representing that he is going to defeat Jerusalem. Or maybe this is just simply pointing out that when David became king and made Jerusalem his hometown, that he had the head of Goliath brought to Jerusalem as like a trophy that he had defeated Goliath. So either one of those, just because it says, then David took the Philistine's head and brought it to Jerusalem, doesn't necessarily mean that it happened immediately after this battle, but that's where it ended up. And it says, but he put his weapon in his tent. So his weapon was put in his tent for the purpose of keeping it. And so maybe David took the Philistine head to Jerusalem as a proof that, you know, they were going to someday fall as well. Or maybe he put it into the city when he became king. Either way, it shows that he defeated the Philistines. Now, verse 55. Now, when Saul saw David going out against the Philistines, he said to Abner, the commander of the army, "Abner, whose son is this young man?" And Abner said, "By your life, O king, I do not know." So this is one of the reasons why I think this is out of order, because they had picked David in chapter 16 to play music for Saul when the evil spirit came upon him. And the evil spirit was more prominent as Saul's reign went on. And the longer he reigned, the more he had bad, it says evil spirits come upon him, or an evil spirit come upon him. Or in other words, he had a really bad attitude, and, you know, maybe he was in depression or anxious or whatever. And so it seems that he would have known who David was if he saw David playing these, you know, was playing instruments for him whenever he was sad. You would think that he might know, but maybe he didn't. And Abner didn't know either, but who he was. And so he says, "By your life, O king, I do not know." And so apparently this was early in David's career. And it says in verse 56, the king said, "You inquire whose son the youth is." And so he wanted Abner, who was going to be the commander, was, you know, part of his general, you might say, in his army, to find out who this young man. So when David returned from killing the Philistines, Abner took him and brought him before Saul with the Philistine's head in his hand. So David then comes to Saul victorious with the head of the Philistine. And Saul says to him, "Whose son are you, young man?" And David answered, "I am the son of your servant Jesse, the Bethlehemite." And so there we see how David gets into the army, and how Saul finally meets him, and David makes an impression on Saul. And so therefore we have the story of the difference between how a leader who's basing his leadership on physical things, and one who's basing his leadership on what God says. Glad you were here. Glad you came. Pray that the Lord blesses you for being here, and pray that he watches over you and grants you peace.